The views expressed on this program are not necessarily the views of Lexington Community Radio or its board of directors. The views expressed are solely those of the programmers.
You are listening to Off the Cuff. Now, here's your host, Adam Banks.
Welcome, everybody, to Off the Cuff. I am Adam Banks, coming at you live from Lexington, Kentucky. Thank you for listening to the show, and thank you for tuning in to WLXU 93.9 FM. In addition to listening to us on the radio, you can check out our Facebook live stream at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks, or you can download the Radio Lex app on your smartphone device to listen anywhere in the entire world. I am broadcasting from Lexington at the WLXU studios. Amber is broadcasting from her home in Lexington. Amber, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing just fine. Those who are trying to access the Facebook Live page, we had some technical difficulties where we're not able to go Facebook Live from Zoom, which is how we both are broadcasting the show remotely. So I don't know if you're going to be able to hear Amber if you are listening to the Facebook Live. So if you want to hear the show in its entirety, this will be the time you will want to turn on the Radio Lex app or go to radiolex.us to hear the show. That's where you'll get good, clear audio of the show. We are live. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. Amber, How are you doing?
Well, you know, it's a beautiful Thursday and hanging out with you for an hour, so I'm doing pretty good. How you doing?
I'm doing fantastic. Today, Amber, is September the 10th, 2020, which means tomorrow is September the 11th, 2020, which marks the 19th anniversary day of the infamous terrorist attacks that happened in this country, on American soil, where our own planes were hijacked by terrorists and crashed into buildings in New York City and in Washington. Nearly 3,000 people were killed, 400 were police officers and firefighters.
And I don't want to forget about Flight 93, the plane they say was intended for the White House, which was hijacked by terrorists and the passengers fought back, but the plane crashed in Pennsylvania.
I was in the 8th grade when this happened.
We were in the 8th grade.
I was 14 years old, and Amber, so were you. And that's where I was getting at. You and I actually were together during the 9/11 attacks. And there are a couple things in this world where you remember where you were when it happened. It might have been when Princess Diana died. It might have been when Michael Jackson died, or Elvis, or something like that. But you remember where you were when you heard about the news of September the 11th, and we were in an 8th grade classroom.
Yep.
Taking social studies.
Do you remember what class we were in? You don't have to say the name.
Of course, yeah. We were in a social studies class. It was the irony in it, too, because that's where you learn a lot about American history. I remember that so well, that happening. And I didn't know what happened. I honestly thought it was pilot error.
Yes. Yes, because remember we were watching it on the box television that was up in the corner, so we had such a grainy picture. We were barely getting any words. It was chaotic even for us in the 8th grade, so I can imagine what it was like out there in the real world.
So, folks, I'm going to play some audio clips that are disturbing. I'm just going to go ahead and warn you, if this is not something that you feel like that you will be able to handle, turn the show off right now. Now, because I'm going to be playing some audio clips that can be very dramatic and disturbing. The first clip that I'm going to play is a flight attendant calling from the actual plane, the first plane that hit the first tower. That is Flight 11. Her name is Betty Ong, and this is when she made the first initial call to let air traffic control know that they have been hijacked. Take a listen.
The cockpit's not answering. Somebody's stabbed in business class. And I think there's mates that we can't breathe. I don't know. I think we're getting hijacked.
Just hearing that is scary, to know that that was the actual flight attendant that was on the plane. And that's her making the call saying that they were getting hijacked. Now, this next recording that I'm going to play is from the actual guy who crashed the plane into the building. And this is him getting on the microphone on the plane, and he is speaking to the passengers aboard Flight 11. Take a listen.
Is that American 11 trying to call?
Buddy, we have some planes. Just stay quiet and you'll be okay. We're returning to the airport.
And who's trying to call me here? American 11, are you trying to call?
Nobody move. Everything will be okay. If you try to make any move, you'll danger yourself and the airplane. Just stay quiet.
So, the guy here, Muhammad Atta, he thought he was talking to the passengers on the plane, but he actually called into air traffic control. So they actually got that message, but he thought he was telling the people on the plane to stay quiet. And I've got one more clip to play, and this is just after the fact that the planes hit the towers. Here is some audio just from that fateful day.
This is about 15 minutes ago, bodies started dropping from the top floors of the tower closest to the highway, about at least five or six, and it was absolutely terrible. Obviously, they had two choices, to be burned in flames or to leap and end it all.
This is as close as we can get to the base of the World Trade Center. You can see the two towers. Debris continues to fall and to rain on the people below. There are people hanging from the windows, 90 stories up, and a number of bodies have actually hit the pavement.
I think that there's some really crazy people in this world. This is just not too many innocent people. People were jumping off the building, body parts all over the place. I mean, this is just... I feel like I was in a movie.
Have you ever seen anything like this?
Absolutely not. I've seen at least 10 people fall to their death and just splat like a ripe tomato. It's awful. But it's, I don't know who was at the controls or what was going on in the plane, but it was not a bomb. It was an American Airlines jet that crashed into the tower.
Pray that God took them.
Everybody was just so confused and terrified and scared because nobody knew what was going to happen next, Amber.
Well, I don't think we'd really ever had anything kind of to this magnitude happen. So I think it was just one of those things that we were not prepared. You know, these people went to sleep tonight, you know, just thinking they were going to get up the next day and go to work or catch a flight. You know, this was definitely not something that anybody saw coming, especially, you know, in the Big Apple. You know, that was a coveted place that people loved to visit. And now this beautiful, once thriving place is just a scene of massacre.
Right. You've watched The Number 23 with Jim Carrey, haven't you?
Yes, I have.
Well, that movie talks about the number 23 and how that number is so involved in his life. And everywhere he looks, he sees the number 23 and how there's codes and messages in his life, maybe his birthday or his wife's birthday or his child's birthday. It all equals up to the number 23. I actually found something when I was looking at some of the things that they have posted on 9/11, and I have found some interesting facts, Amber, about the number 11. About the number 11. Yes. So, the number 11 in the Bible means judgment. That's what the number 11 means. It means judgment. It means God's judgment. So God is a God of numbers. There's no denying that. I mean, he even dedicated a whole book in the Bible to it, the book of numbers. For anyone to say God's not a God of numbers, it's nonsense. He is. He's full of numbers. Full. And he builds things, thinks of things with numbers. So you tell me if this is a coincidence or if this is just, if this is a sheer coincidence or maybe it's fact. You be the judge. So like I said, the number 11 equals judgment. New York City has 11 letters. Afghanistan has 11 letters. Ramzan Yousef was the terrorist who threatened to destroy the Twin Towers in 93, has 11 letters in his name. New York City is the 11th state admitted into the U.S. The first plane that crashed into the towers was Flight 11.
11.
Flight 11 was carrying 92 passengers. 9 plus 2 equals
11.
Flight 77, which also hit the towers, was carrying 65 passengers. 6 plus 5 equals
11.
The tragedy was on September the 11th. On 9/11 As it is known, 9 plus 1 plus 1 equals 11. The date is equal to the U.S. Emergency Service telephone number, 911. 9 plus 1 plus 1 equals 11. The total number of victims inside of all of the hijacked planes was 254 people. 2 plus 5 plus 4 is, guess what? It's 11. September the 11th is a day... Number 254 of the calendar year. Again, 2 plus 5 plus 4 equals 11. The Madrid bombing took place on 3/11/2004. 3 plus 1 plus 1 plus 2 plus 4 equals 11. The tragedy, or the most recognized symbol for the U.S. after the stars and stripes, is the eagle. The following verse is taken from the Quran, the Islamic holy book. Let me read it to you. For it is written that a son of Arabia would awaken a fearsome eagle. The wrath of the eagle would be felt throughout the lands. The verse is 9:11 of the Quran. Type in capitals Q33 space NY. This is the flight number of the first plane to hit one of the Twin Towers. Change the actual font to Wingdings, and you will get an image of a plane hitting two towers. And before I end all of this, I will just say that the towers that stood so tall in the sky looks like a number 11. So is it a coincidence or is it not? I don't know. I just thought that was something else. But September 11th, it is a day that we will never forget in this country. But Amber, I want to talk about not just September 11th. I want to talk about September 10th, 2001. And that is actually, we are now today at that day. We are 19 years from that day where... It was the last day that the world was forever different. It was just another day at the time of the calendar year. I mean, in the news, there was hardly anything going on. It was just talking about tough commutes to work and talking about the economy. But here are some of the things that were happening just the day before the world changed on September 11th. That was actually going on today, 19 years ago. So here's what was happening. Here's what was happening around the world. Michael Jackson was doing his 30th anniversary show in New York City when he did the famous moonwalk with the Billie Jean. Yes. Venus beat Serena in the U.S. Open. Barry Bonds was chasing a home run record 18 years ago or 19 years ago today. The Musketeer was the biggest movie in the world. I Keep On Falling In Love With You was the biggest song in the world. Who Wants to Be a Millionaire was the biggest show in the world. You kept your shoes on in airports. You didn't have to put toothpaste in little baggies. The world was just different. You know, Amber, I flew out of that same airport that the Flight 11 flew out of in Newark, New Jersey. And I flew out of that airport in 2003. And I remember being so terrified because I was in that same airport where it all happened. And...
I'll give you a better.
Yeah.
I flew into and out of Newark in 2001. So, you know, I spent a lot of my summer in New Jersey, our eighth grade summer transitioning in. We actually lived there for a little while.
Wow.
So one of the last trips that I took was actually to New York. I actually took that. We'd already started school back. We were in school and we took a weekend trip up. So I think this was in August and then about 3 weeks later. And I'll tell you, you know, I actually kind of remember what it was like going in there. It was easy peasy lemon squeezy. You walk right in, you got your boarding pass, you got your identification. On the plane you go, my friend.
Yeah, they let anybody get away with anything. I mean,
you could meet people like when, you know, you had somebody you loved coming home, you could actually go to their gate.
Like they do in the movies.
Yes, you ain't doing that now.
No, look how much things have changed. I mean, you used to not even have to take your shoes off at the airport.
No. I can remember the first time I flew after that. I was like, wait, I have to take my shoes off. Why?
I'm so glad, though.
Yeah, we were children.
Yeah, I'm so glad, though, that they have added restrictions on who can get on a plane and the precautions that you got to take before you let people on a plane. I'm so glad they do that because they were too lax before 9/11.
Yes. Very, very, very lax.
And it takes something like that to happen for people and companies to pay attention to stuff like that. Sad but true.
It does.
Sad but true.
It's very tragic.
But it was the last day before the first day of now. But ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a quick break, and we got lots more Off the Cuff coming at you live right after these words. Stick with us. It's when you're a celebrity, it's adios reality. You can act just like a fool, people think you're cool. Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you, broadcasting from the WLXU studios here in Lexington. Amber is also joining me at her home. Reality TV has grown immensely throughout the years, and that's a large part of that is because of one family, the Kardashians. Season 20 will mark the final season of Keeping Up with the Kardashians. Amber, are you going to be okay?
I'm not really sure because, you know, we've spent how many years now watching the Kardashians? They're kind of like a staple. They're your, like, go-to reality show to watch. So I can't answer that right now.
I mean,
you going to be okay?
I think, look, Kardashians, it was time for them to go. I think they realized that nobody watches TV anymore. And if exactly. they are going to still remain relevant, they have to switch things up. I don't think this is the end for the Kardashians, by no means. I think that they're going to move on to bigger and better things. They may move on to a streaming service, maybe like Netflix.
Oh, yeah.
But I don't...
This is definitely not the last we'll see of them, no.
No. They've got something up their sleeve for them just to say goodbye. But you got to think, though. Things are forever going to be different for this family when the cameras finally do turn off. I mean, they no longer have that platform to defend themselves at every second. They have that platform to use to take care of their PR for them. So anytime there's a scandal, let's say it's maybe whether it's the Jordan Woods scandal or it's the Lamar Odom scandal or it's the Chris Humphries and Kim Kardashian scandal, regardless, they had that show to tell the story from their eyes, from their point of view. So you showed sympathy for the Kardashians because they were the narrators and they got to narrate their entire life. That's not going away anymore. When that show finally goes away and something happens in the news about the Kardashians, they don't have that show to go on and take care of their PR for them anymore.
Nope. Looks like they're going to have to, maybe clean up their act a little bit. I feel like they got a little lax there for a while. You know, we had a couple of scandals, you know, out from them. And, you know, I understand their family, just like my family. My family's got plenty of scandals. But, you know, we're not all over the news. And I feel like there for like a 2-year time period, it was consistently each sister getting on there, defending their choice, whether it be in men or whether it be, you know, in friends. I feel like they had the chance to get on there and defend all of these things that some of us would have loved the opportunity just to be like, hey, here's what I'm thinking. So.
Right. Yeah. So you also got to think, too, that when they're on TV, it's just them. When you watch people on TV, you can't. There's no comment section. They don't have to worry about a comment section. They don't have to worry about anything like that, like YouTube or Twitter, where you can just post back to people's videos. No, when the Kardashians show you their life on TV, you just have to sit there and watch. So if they do decide,
we'll turn it off.
If they do decide to go into this internet world, they're going to have to start looking at comments about their show as it airs. So it's a totally, it's a totally different world.
They won't do that. I mean, maybe if they get hard up for cash, but you know they're not going to do that. They're going to disable them comments real fast.
Since
commenting will be available after the live.
Since the Keeping Up with the Kardashian series premiered on October the 14th, 2007, there have been 12 spinoff series on E. That's the channel that they're on, including Kourtney and Khloe Take Miami, Kourtney and Kim Take New York, Kourtney and Kim Take Miami, Kourtney and Khloe Take the Hamptons, Khloe and Lamar, Sex with Brody, I Am Kate, Dash Dolls, Life of Kylie, Rob in China, Revenge Body with Khloe Kardashian, and Flip It Like Disick. So that whole channel was pretty much the Kardashian channel.
Are we sure that E really isn't a K?
I mean, wasn't the Kardashians the real life Truman Show?
I mean, honestly, yes. I've never looked at it like that, but yeah, I can see that.
I mean, we're following their lives. I mean, we watch some of their children grow up from the delivery room.
And I'm really trying to figure out, like, what's so interesting about them. Like,
nothing.
I feel like nothing. You know, people talked, I want to say it was like 6 months, people talked about the way that Khloe Kardashian lines her cookies.
Yeah.
In a cookie jar.
Yeah.
Do you remember that?
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, so when I get me a pack of Oreos, I just slap that thing open and dump it in. Like, I'm not going to sit there and stack each one.
Yeah.
Who does that?
I don't know what the appeal is about those ladies, but they, for some reason, there was something about them that people could not get enough of. And those girls, say what you want to about them, those women, they dominated reality television. They dominated E! Network, and they dominated in the ratings for a long time. They are successful. They took just a small, measly reality show that a lot of people back in 2000 would have just made fun of a lot just because you're on reality TV. They took what they had, and they made themselves multimillionaires, and some even made themselves $1 billion.
Billionaire.
So, I mean, you can't hate on them for capitalizing on their success.
No, we made them that successful.
Yeah.
We did. Literally, I think you and I did, because I'm pretty sure we're the only people that really watched.
I mean, it's not like I'm like obsessed with the Kardashians or not. It's just like, it's one of those things. I'm not going to lie and say that I have not seen it before, because that would be a lie. I have watched it before. But I will say that Keeping Up with the Kardashian returns September 17th at 8 p.m. That is next Thursday for a 19th season. And then they will have a final 20th season that will air in early 2021. It truly is an end of an era. But ladies and gentlemen, it is time for Off the Cuff to take its Song of the Week break. And I had a song picked out already for this week, but I changed things because today is a very special day. It is the anniversary of Amber Turner and her husband, Wiley Turner. They are celebrating 6 years of marriage. And we're going to talk about your all's marriage, and we're going to talk about what kind of plans you guys got going on after the song. But ladies and gentlemen, this song is dedicated from Amber to her husband, Wiley. It's a little George Thorogood and the Destroyers, Bad to the Bone. Ladies and gentlemen, stick with us. We'll be back after the song. It's hard not to think of that movie Problem Child whenever I hear that song. Please tell me you maybe even for a second think of Problem Child when you hear that song.
I mean, have you not seen my husband? Have you not checked him out? Guys, if you've not checked out my husband, give him a little look-see if you get some free time. He looks exactly like the kid from Problem Child.
So before the song of the week, that's hilarious, Amber. I just made the connection. No. So before we took the song of the week, I said it was Amber and her husband Wiley's wedding anniversary. They have been married for 6 years. 6 years. So Amber, I have a couple
Wonderful
questions
years.
For you. Wonderful year. Okay. So I can say, or you can say, that you are happily married.
You know, I think marriage is just one of them things that when you slap a label like that on it, you know, marriage really is teamwork and it's hard work. So to say happily, I think I'd be lying, but we are thankful to be married. All right, that's a better word.
Well,
married.
Let me ask you, when you first got married in the beginning, what was the most difficult part for you about being married in the beginning?
Him refusing, I mean, outright refusing to put his clothes in the clothes hamper.
That bothered
like
you?
That bothered me. That was my trigger, you know, because, you know, we'd lived together for a while, which, you know, was definitely something I recommend. Don't ever marry somebody that you ain't live with, guys, because you need to get some things figured out.
Okay.
What temperature you like your house to be set at.
Okay.
What side of the bed you like to lay on.
All those things matter. Yeah.
Yeah, they matter. There's some things you got to go through.
So did you guys did you guys have disagreements with what side of the bed you liked? Or is Wiley a type of person who's like, whatever you say, baby?
He's whatever you say, baby.
That's the key.
He's a firm believer in happy wife, happy life. He really is.
What would you say is the key to having a successful marriage?
The key to having a successful marriage is the understanding that you both, at the end of the day, want the same thing. You both have to continuously work on your partnership. It has to be something where you have to understand that you do have to be vulnerable with your partner. There's some absurd things I've heard that women do, like, you know, that they refuse to allow their partners, you know, to see them do certain things. You kind of got to get over that. They're your partner for life. I mean, because I like to think that that's maybe why people get married. It's for lifetime. Understand things don't work out, but that doesn't need to be your first thought. So you need to be comfortable with whoever you marry.
Can I go ahead and just add to that, too, for you? This is just an observation of something that I've noticed about your all's marriage, and I think very highly of that. Just by watching you guys being married, you and Wiley have remained individuals, and you both have remained as a couple, but you still do your own thing. You have kind of built your own part, your own like section of the house. Wiley's kind of built his own section of the house. And when I say that, I don't want people to think that, oh, Amber and Wiley live in one house, but they have two separate apartments in this house. No, they have created for themselves their own space to go, to be themselves. They hang up the things that they want to hang up on their walls. The color of carpet is the color they want it. The color wall, everything is suited to how they want it. And I just think that that is something that can cause a marriage to be more successful, because it gives you space away from your partner who you live with every day. And I don't understand partners who get so mad when their partner is away from them just for a second. Oh, you can't go hang out with your friends because I need you home, even though you live with me.
No, that's, you know, honestly, I think that's going to be, you know what, that's going to be the advice I give to people. Marry someone who allows you to be an individual and to have your friends. Because, you know, I think about how much I cherish our friendship. And guys, I do. Like, I just want you to know, I love this man. He's a good man, not just because I'm on the show with him, but my husband understands that my best friend in life.
Oh, you're talking about me.
Sex.
You're talking about me.
Yeah, I'm talking about you.
Oh, wow. Yes. Yes. Oh, yeah. Thank you.
You know, and that's, you know, we've all been in relationships before where our partners have been very gung-ho about, no, you know, you are not allowed to, you know, what do you mean you want to go to the movies with a man?
Yeah.
And my husband will happily drop us off to the movie. You know, you guys have fun, pick you up later, you know. Make sure you marry somebody who understands that, just like Adam said, you are an individual, and you got to keep growing as a person, not just as a married couple.
Exactly. Well, happy anniversary to Amber and Wiley Turner for a happy 6 years and many more. Denise Shepherd on the show thread says, I couldn't hear Amber on the live, so I went to the website because I don't want to listen without her, and I don't blame you. So, ladies and gentlemen, if you tuned in to the Facebook Live, you're not able to hear Amber today. We're having some technical difficulties. So to hear the show in its entirety, tune in to Radio Lex, the app, or 93.9 FM. We're on the radio. The audio is clear.
Thank you, Denise.
And I guess you've just answered of who you like more on the show.
Hey, Denise and I are friends.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back with another segment here on Off the Cuff. Stick with us.
We'll raise up our glasses against evil forces, singing whiskey for my men, beer for my.
Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Amber Turner is also joining me. The Kentucky Derby was just last week. I would almost call this the most forgotten derby of all time because hardly anybody watched. Amber, the ratings were the lowest ratings of any derby in history. I would say partly because of all of the changes. You can have no crowd. It's a different month.
Yeah.
I mean, the ratings were pretty terrible. But the derby was, in fact, this past week. And like I said, the ratings were pretty horrible. And I will say, though, that it was the highest rated and most watched sportscast since April.
I will.
I mean, it's actually, it said that it was the most watched sports event since the NFL draft. And I mean, that's saying something because the NBA playoffs are going on right now. So, I mean, it's still pretty poorly, though, because the Derby is used to seeing like 18, 19 million people tune in. But they saw last week only 9 million people tune in. That is a huge drop in ratings for the Kentucky Derby. Did you get a chance to watch it, Amber?
I didn't watch the full thing, but I did make sure that I watched who won.
Mm-hmm.
Just because I actually know some people who were involved with this horse. So I seen that they were all posting on Facebook, and I thought, you know what? I know somebody that owns a horse that's racing. I'm gonna keep up with it.
I reckon. Who was it?
I do reckon. Who owns it?
Yeah. Or who's the horse?
I'm not telling you that.
It's a secret?
No, I mean, it was just a friend of mine posted on Facebook that his uncle owned a part of the horse. And I was like, okay, that's kind of cool. I'm going to watch it then.
Oh.
You know, since you're your uncle.
Well, Authentic won the Derby. And I love that because that horse is from Kentucky. The race gave trainer Bob Baffert his sixth win in the Kentucky Derby. That's a name that you hear every year when it comes to the Derby is Bob Baffert. Baffert gave credit for the win to jockey John Valquez and assistant trainer Jimmy Barnes. Hundreds of protesters, though, Amber, started out with filling the streets before the Derby began in honor of Breonna Taylor for racial justice. You know, they still haven't.
Yes.
They still have not came to a decision on what they're going to do to the police officers that shot and killed Breonna Taylor. But yeah, there was some noise made for her before the Derby started. But
yeah,
the Derby in the Bluegrass, it was sad because usually that is Kentucky's day to shine in the national spotlight. People from all over the world fly in to Louisville, to Churchill Downs, to watch the Derby. Do you remember, or have you ever heard of a woman, Amber, by the name of Anita Madden?
Is she the lady that used to throw parties here in Lexington?
Yes, she is the woman who is very famous and known for her Kentucky Derby Eve bashes. They were absolutely extravagant. They were celebrity studded, and it attracted as many as 25,000 people. Or wow. I'm sorry, not 25,000 people. It attracted as many as 2,500 people to her mansion to go to the party. And like I said, it was star-studded. So you had people like Chuck Norris there. You had like Burt Bacharach there. Molly Shannon was there. And yes, I did say Burt Bacharach. But you had so many celebrities there, and the parties were a little scandalous. I mean, you had half-naked male servers. You had topless young women dressed as mermaids that would walk around and serve drinks at the party.
I think this is a party we should probably go to. I wish they still a bumping them.
She died in her 80s, and she died like 2 years ago, I want to say, 2018. Oh. But this woman, Anita Madden, she became famous because of her parties. She was famous. She was known as a party hostess. That's what they know her. That's what they knew her as in the fame world.
Yeah.
But she was rich. She got all of her money because she owned the Hamburg Farms, and she got really lucky because in the 1960s, half of her farm was cut in half because Interstate 64 cut right through there, which made that woman millions and millions of dollars. And now we have the Hamburg Pavilion in Lexington, owned by Anita Madden.
Is so the mansion that we have here on Winchester Road, is that her home? Is that the home that these parties are held at?
So if you want to see the house that all of these parties was held in, the famous Derby parties, they were held in that mansion on Winchester Road that still stands. It's right beside of Polo Club Boulevard. So if you are in the Hamburg area and you know where the Polo Club Boulevard is, Anita Madden's brick, three-story
mansion
still stands. Now, it looks aged and it's got some character behind it, but that woman had more money than she knew what to do with it. She she could swallow people in money is what she had.
Well, I have a fun fact about her house, actually.
What's that?
It was on a scary movie that was created by Sci-Fi, I want to say maybe about 3 years ago.
Really?
Yes, you can Google it. I do not know the actual name of it. I'm sorry. I'm coming up so short today on my facts. But you can Google it. Sci-Fi did, in fact, make a movie that does feature this mansion in it.
It said
very
that
ominous.
Anita was from Ashland, Kentucky, and her husband, Preston Madden, is the one who owned the farm with her, and they used to breed horses. So there's got to be money in horse breeding, because look at Anita Madden.
Oh, yes.
And not
there's
to mention,
money in horses in general.
And not to mention the interstate going through her farm didn't hurt her any at all either.
That might have lined her pocket with a little more cheddar than them horses did.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take our last commercial break, and we'll be back with our last segment here on Off the Cuff. Stick with us. Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you, last segment of the hour. Amber Turner is also joining me. Breaking news. In a meeting with Board of Trustees, Mitch Barnhart says UK will allow 12,000 fans at games, 10 people in each suite, and no tailgating. Also says UK will give tickets based on K-Fund points, and that is from WKYT. So there you go. There will be no tailgating this year at UK football, and that UK will only allow 12,000 fans in its stadium. Amber, what do you make of the breaking news?
I would really love for us to try to get tickets to go, because this might be our chance to go see some sports live.
I know, and I would be willing to do that. Speaking of sports, the NFL starts this Sunday. I'm very excited for that, partly because I love to gamble on sports, and I'm a part of many fantasy football leagues, or I'm a member of one fantasy league, but I look forward to doing it. But yes.
You know, I have a question, just a question.
Go ahead.
At some point during this fantasy football season, can you do a small tutorial for people like me who have no clue what you guys are doing?
Yeah, no problem.
I have no clue what fantasy football is.
Okay.
And I know I am not the only one.
Just, okay, what fantasy sports is, it's basically, it's a fantasy. It's a fantasy team. So,
okay, okay, I got a question. Do you pick like whole teams, or are y'all like picking and pulling players that you want?
So we pick and pull players that we want. So every player in the league, let's say the football league, we have every player available to draft, and then you just draft them on your fake team that you made up, and you end up at the end of your draft, you have players from several different other teams, but they're on your one fantasy team. So it's a fantasy team.
And like your dream team,
I guess. And you play with that team. And then the point system is set up different per league. It's up to the owner of the fantasy league on how they want to set the points. Usually there's committees and everything with these leagues where we decide on how the points are going to be made. Yeah, it's
that's a lot.
I've seen a lot of people go all out with fantasy. I'm not kidding you, Amber. Like, my fantasy football league has a whole production when it comes to the draft lottery. I mean, we produce an actual 15-minute video that's professionally produced to do our lottery draft.
I mean, I'm not going to hate on that because that sounds kind of cool, but man, that's a lot of work. I mean, is it not supposed to be like a fun activity?
It is.
I mean, I know how much you like doing things that are of production, and you know, you dig this, but I just wonder for like people like me who have no clue about things, like how would I even go about like joining a league that's like chill and I don't have to do all that?
If you don't like football, you're not going to like the league. And if you don't like the sport in general, you're not going to like the league at all.
Yeah.
So if you're not really a sports fanatic, you're probably not going to like the fantasy league, because you got to keep up with it. And yeah, it's not something
like,
you
do
just
you have to keep your own score, or
no, it's all computerized and done for you.
Okay. Well, see, this is getting a little easier.
But, yes, the NFL, it does start this Sunday. As you know, the NBA playoffs are well underway, and NBA is it's been in the spotlight. It's trying to crown a new world champ after a four-month suspension due to COVID-19. And the Lakers and LeBron are doing very well. LeBron has been in the news. He's been in the front of the news a lot, partly because of the playoffs, but again, because of Black Lives Matter. He's a big voice behind that movement. And it started making me think about LeBron James just as a player and as a person. I feel like LeBron James has always been vilified. I feel like that LeBron James is a heel. If we're looking at it in a wrestling standpoint, he would be a heel.
He's a heel.
He would be a villain. And ESPN has this docuseries streaming on the ESPN app. It's called it's called The Backstory. It's a TV show where every episode focuses on just a famous event in sports. And one of the episodes focused on the 10-year anniversary of LeBron James announcing that he would take his talents to South Beach. And that happened in 2010 when that happened. And that happened back in July, so a little bit over 10 years. But that is when that occurred. And that was a public relations disaster when he said that, because LeBron was a Cleveland hero. He was from Cleveland, and he had this big press conference to announce, Amber, that he was going to leave his hometown and take his talents to another place. And it wasn't really what he said. It was exactly how he said it. I mean, making a big deal out of just breaking everybody's heart. He made a big deal just to break everybody's heart. And he told his teammates just minutes before he made the decision live in front of the world. Yeah, and a lot of people figured that he would stay in Cleveland. And just the fact that he just, I don't know, one fan said this. This isn't a fan. It was the owner of the Cleveland Cavaliers. Mm-hmm. He said, I thought he was going to stay in Cleveland. The only reason to have a press conference the way LeBron did was to make your hometown fans excited, and then you announce you're investing more years and you're staying put. I couldn't believe that he said, I'm out of here for Miami. It was a total shock. And it really was. I mean, LeBron, what are you doing? Why did you do that? And that, if anything, didn't help your favoritism with people liking you. If you want to shake that vilified image, you don't do something like that. Now, of course, that was 10 years ago, and he was young, and he's grown a lot. But I still feel like even in 2020, people still vilify LeBron James. People don't like him. Those that love him, love him. But if you don't like LeBron, you don't like him at all.
I mean, I will say that I feel like, you know, I'm not a huge sports fan, but I do see, you know, how people will kind of blast him on Facebook all of the time. No, irregardless of what this man does, he does get blasted. So I guess he's like the permanent heel.
Yeah. So he ended up eventually making his way back to Cleveland, and it was a very I'm coming home end of a movie story. It was like a very popular movie. And he did actually lead the Cavaliers to a NBA championship in 2016. And it was the city's first major professional sports title in 52 years. So he did make up for it. He did come back and he did win a title. But the whole point of that, of talking about the decision that happened 10 years ago when he went and announced his talents being taken to South Beach, even in 2020, LeBron James, I think people love to hate him. People loved Jordan. People loved Magic. People loved Shaq. Those three who could be considered the GOAT. People love those guys. LeBron, somebody else who could be considered the GOAT, is someone people just love to hate. And I'm here for it. Because I don't like LeBron James.
I was going to say, like, wait, I thought we didn't like LeBron James.
I don't. I'm not a big fan of the man. But ladies and gentlemen, It is about that time again for Off the Cuff to wrap things up. So let me just say, if you want to listen to all of our previous episodes, you can do that by going to the podcast app and typing in Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. We're on iTunes, we're on Spotify, YouTube, or wherever podcasts can be streamed. You can follow Off the Cuff on Facebook at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. You could follow me, the host, at The Adam Banks on all social media platforms. You could follow the co-host, Amber, at Ambu447 on all social media platforms. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be back with a brand new episode next Thursday on Radio Lex, WLXU 93.9 FM. I'm Adam Banks. That is Amber Turner, and this is Off the Cuff. We'll see you next Thursday from 4 to 5.
All the glory, I just do it anyway.